My name is Praneeth Susarla, and I'm a final year doctoral researcher at Center for Machine Vision and Signal Analysis in University of Oulu. Today, I'm going to discuss about the topic, learning strategies for joint communications and sensing. Let's carefully look into this figure where there are built environments. There are two phases around these built environments. One is indoor, and then there is an outdoor environment as well. So let's say, for example, there's a drone, and usually the drones are equipped with cameras and wireless sensors and so on. So now in the upcoming 6G era, the wireless nodes, even on the top of a drones, are going to be more cellular connected, which means they are more directional in nature and have reflective properties similar to that of light. As you see here, the drone has to transmit a signal in a particular direction, and depending on where the person is standing, you might have to transmit the signal in line of sight or in a non-line of sight. The similar goes around when even in the indoor environment as well. For example, you take the example of any room, you see the wireless devices getting connected to the access point, and then you also see cameras everywhere used for surveillance in the environments and so on. What we expect is that in the 6G era, there will be a co-design, coexistence and collaboration between the cameras and radios because of their ubiquitous presence in the environment. And the millimeter wave spectrum and 5G and beyond have shorter coverages because of smaller antenna sizes, resulting in miniature radio cells. So as a result, the number of radio cells are going to increase as well, almost one for every closed environment. So resulting also in ultra-densification of cameras and radios together. So this overall builds a complex environment, and this can be facilitated only using artificial intelligence. Let's look into millimeter wave communication in general. As you see the picture on the top, you see the spectrum chart where we have the 4G standard used until 6 gigahertz frequency spectrum, and then the 5G extending from 6 gigahertz until 100, around 90 gigahertz, and anything beyond 90 gigahertz until 3 terahertz is usually considered as the upcoming 6G spectrum. Let's move on to the next figure. As you see below, so with increase in frequency, you see the wavelength reduces. Wavelength of the radio wave keeps reducing. So for example, the terahertz band, as you see here, is going from millimeter wave to sub-millimeter wave wavelength. This results in some interesting properties in both 5G as well as 6G spectrum, which is directional transmission. This is happening mainly due to two important techniques in millimeter wave communication, which is MIMO, multiple inputs and multiple outputs, spatial multiplexing combined with beamforming. In addition to this, it also has a reflection properties pretty much similar to the light because of the shorter wavelength of the millimeter spectrum. So this also brings in a couple of challenges. As antenna size becomes smaller, so more number of antenna elements can be equipped on one RF receiver, resulting in a significant increase of antenna elements such as MIMO or massive MIMO and so on. And then the channel conditions in millimeter wave spectrum are much more adverse compared to the previous technologies, which is also a significant challenge to address in millimeter wave communication. And then the coverage and blockages and the environment, whether it's an outdoor or indoor, or how dense is it, a macro environment or a micro environment. So all these can factor the reliability of a millimeter wave communications during the deployments. The same problem can also be viewed from the sensing point of view, as the millimeter waves are pretty much directional in nature. So the objects in the environment, whether static or dynamic, always heavily impact the radio measurements because of the millimeter wave directionality. So from the sensing point of view, it's also maybe useful to understand the object, whether it's static or dynamic, or what sort of activity is happening with respect to the object based on its radio properties. However, this can be quite complex, especially with the added millimeter wave properties such as line of sight, non-line of sight, interference effects, adverse channel conditions, and so on. Having an extra environmental information, which is especially the channel, the spatial information of the environment, something like using cameras, can be highly beneficial because the radio signals are generally temporal in nature. Sensing from using radio signals can either be active or passive. By active sensing means that the radio signals are predominantly used for sensing, which is in that of a radar, whereas a passive sensing is usually observed through radios which are predominantly used for communication, such as Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, Zigbee, etc. Based on these properties, we can say that in millimeter wave spectrum, the sensing and communication phenomena may aid each other. So let's now look into some of the hardware resources also which are existing on both cameras and radios. On the bottom, you see the infrastructure of a radio head from Nokia Network Systems. As you see, there are remote radio heads, multiple remote radio heads, which are connected either through optical fiber links or through backhaul links, which can be processed, where the information can be collected and processed together in a virtual base station pool, which has right from application layer till the hardware layer. So as you see here in this figure, there's also a separate computing layer, which takes care of all the computational resources corresponding to this architecture. So delving more into this computational unit, we see on the top, there are multiple processing cores, such as DSP units or general processor cores around the transceivers, which help in faster processing of the millimeter wave signals. So this shows that the hardware resources, these processing cores are predominantly used for signal processing related tasks, which is also equally observed the same even in cameras, like as you see on the bottom left, which is a typical silicon hardware architecture in Apple phones, where you see a separate processing core even for vision-based applications such as neural engines or GPUs and so on. So first important thing to notice is that the radios and cameras are ubiquitous. And then the collected radio and camera data can be processed on a common hardware, which is existing in these days. However, there are some synchronization challenges while collecting the data from diverse sources such as camera and radio. So this way, these hardware sources facilitate the need or facilitate the usage of a joint communication and sensing applications. But at the same time, they also have certain challenges to be addressed. These are some of the upcoming or ongoing joint communication and sensing applications. For example, drones have heavily being used nowadays in agriculture for crop monitoring. The cameras and the wireless system has to precisely localize the crop and monitor the crop with the help of a camera. And then we have camera-aided RIS, reflective intelligent surfaces. And then we also have a camera-aided base stations for efficient beam searching or beam alignment algorithms. And then we also have a drone radar surveillance, where the cameras are used to locate the person, and then the drone's search can be optimized based on the camera input received from the environments. And then we also see cameras and radios used together in ray tracing simulators and the current hot trend of autonomous driving as well. So having understood the importance of joint communication and sensing applications, and also the complexities involved in addressing these challenges, I think it's important to understand now the learning strategies that can be involved in tackling some of these challenges. So the design criteria for a learning strategy in joint communication and sensing has to be the following way. It has to suit the camera and radio sampling rates, and it has to follow the current 3GPP communication standards, and the strategies have to be simple and effective. And most important of all, the learning strategies used has to eventually support ultra-densification, which is going to be in the future. On the right side, you see the typical machine learning chart, which can be eventually divided into supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. So supervised learning is usually dealt with the labeled data and driven around the labeled data. Unsupervised learning is a bit similar to supervised learning, just that it doesn't have any unlabeled data, and so it is heavily dependent on unlabeled data. Reinforcement learning is nothing but learning by interaction, where there is an agent and an interpreter, and it learns by interacting with the environment actively. So let's look into now the supervised learning strategies that could be deployed for JCNS. This is an example of a supervised learning architecture. As you see on the left, there is a radio head and then there is a camera which can provide different input information such as range Doppler info or a signal strength indicator information or a channel state information and so on. And similarly, camera can provide some inputs which are specific to certain applications such as person tracking or activity tracking or action recognition and so on. So these needs to be processed mainly to handle the synchronization or to deal them with in a time domain or a frequency domain or a Doppler domain to collect the different features and then send to the neural networks as an input. And the output from these neural networks is essentially to predict the different data labels corresponding to the application of choice, which then can be compared against the ground truth data provided usually by the cameras. So this is a typical sub-architecture that can be useful in joint communication and sensing. However, this architecture requires an offline model training with the and also it requires a labeled data set beforehand. And once the model has been trained offline, it can be used online multiple times. So this is the principle of a supervised learning architecture. And since the usage is designed in this way, the training nodes, whether it's Wi-Fi nodes or the camera nodes which are used for training, requires frequent model updates once in a while to facilitate the changing environments. So these supervised learning architectures are usually complex and heavily used in computer vision algorithms, are transferred to communications as well. As I said here, having this labeled data set for every application of our choice can be quite tedious and difficult. So these are some of the cons of this architecture. And now to support ultra-densification, these can be easily deployed in inference mode, which can be quite practical. So moving on to unsupervised learning, this form of learning doesn't depend on any labeled data, doesn't require any labeled data to start with. So once you have a data which is collected corresponding to an application, that could be either coming from a Wi-Fi node or a camera, so it can be pre-processed as before and then sent into a neural network, where here the neural network tries to learn the underlying features of the input data by forming an encoder-decoder network. So this is one example of an unsupervised learning algorithm which is predominantly used, also known as deep autoencoders. And the features that are learned in the middle of this network can actually be used as a fingerprint to recognize particular kind of input data for the application. Even this form of architecture facilitates an offline model training used online only in the inference mode. The advantage of this is it doesn't require a labeled data set. However, it does depend on complex learning architectures and also is more data driven in the sense that compared to supervised learning, unsupervised learning requires much more data to start with to train the algorithm. And the training nodes also here require frequent model updates to accommodate the changing environments. And even unsupervised learning architectures can be used in inference mode to support ultra-densification. And the third form of learning strategy is a reinforcement learning strategy. Here, you usually have an environment and an agent and an interaction between them. So the agent here is usually comprises of some neural networks followed by some reinforcement learning algorithm, and where the objective is to approximate learning between the state and the action mapping. So whenever game starts with an agent applying an action on the environment and the environment pre-processes the data, takes in the action and changes its state, the observed state is sent back to the agent to decide its subsequent action. So for every action applied on the environment, a reward is obtained from the environment, which also helps the agent in choosing its subsequent action. So here, unlike the previous two architectures, this is an online-based form of learning, and it's a goal-oriented learning, and it doesn't require any prior data to start with, and it learns interactively as we go along. However, the drawback of this architecture is that it has slow convergence compared to the remaining two strategies, and it can easily support ultra-densification using the multi-agent form of reinforcement learning. So some of the learning challenges in designing these strategies are as follows. One of the first important challenge is the data fusion and integration because of the combination of diverse modality data heavily used between cameras and radios, the quality data collection and regulatory compliance is one more important challenge to be addressed because of the heavy GDPR issues that comes around in the usage of cameras and radios and the spectrum allocations given to sensors for their usage and the resource constraints in terms of the bandwidth for sensor data, limited processing power, and also the energy consumption. And representation learning is also a quite important challenge to address. For example, what are the better ways to combine the camera and radio input data? Can this be combined at the decision level or at the feature level or a combination of these? It has to be carefully interpreted. And privacy and security concerns in the usage of the visual data and the secure communication protocols during the transmission of the visual data and privacy preservation during sensing in the applications is an important challenge to be addressed. And other challenge is also the scalability. Even though the current learning strategies can facilitate towards a scalable usage of cameras and radios, from the algorithmic point of view, the strategies has to be enhanced much further to support multiple camera and multiple radio-based learnings. This is quite important for millimeter wave radio challenges. So the learning architecture complexity is also one more important challenge to be addressed because the designed feasible strategies has to be easy to deploy on the underlying computational hardware as well. Thank you for this opportunity. Feel free to reach out to me in case you have any questions.